I'm happy to be back here with you and happy to have such wonderful guests here. Let me thank, first of all, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution for creating this journalism-related track and for putting us on it. I want to thank the Georgia Humanities Council for its involvement in here and putting us on their track. And I want to thank the Rose Library at Emory University, the Stuart A. Rose Manuscript Archives and Rare Book Library for their help in this whole enterprise. We're here today for two reasons related to the calendar. One is that this is the 50th anniversary of the year that Gene Patterson was awarded the Pulitzer Prize, okay? And I want to show you this real quickly. Works. What do I mean by that? That's what it looked like, okay? And also because some last fall, through the great help of Roy Peter Clark, one of our guests here, and the Poynter Institute for Media Studies in St. Petersburg, Florida, the Rose Library was successful in obtaining the papers of Gene Patterson. And you're going to get to see a few samples of them, but I'm going to click through them quickly because I don't want to cut too much time out of what our guests have to say. I am going to start off by introducing our guests from my immediate right here, Howell Raines, who was a reporter here at the Atlanta Constitution. I'm not going to try to give you all the years and all of that, but he certainly, I know he got his start at the Birmingham newspapers, the Post-Herald and the Birmingham News, which means, not to make you feel old, Howell, that I was delivering your byline, okay? The Birmingham News in my hometown of Florence, Alabama, okay? That is, then Gene Patterson hired him from the Atlanta Constitution to the St. Petersburg Times. And as many of you know, he ultimately made his way to the New York Times. He was editor of the editorial page. He was editor of the executive editor of the newspaper. And I think I am correct in saying that his first day on the job was something like September 9th, 2001. And I think I'm also, I can't tell you the tally, not that he would remember, of how many Pulitzer Prizes the New York Times won for their performance 2 days later and in the days after that. But it set a record.
Staff won seven.
Thank you. The staff won seven Pulitzer Prizes for their coverage of 9/11. Howell, it's great to have you back in Atlanta. Everyone knows Ambassador Young, but golly, you know, I could spend forever talking about his role as ambassador, his role as the mayor, and his involvement in the movement, and as you know, the lieutenant and sidekick of Dr. King, and in and out of Atlanta and throughout the South during that very difficult period. And you know, it's remarkable that so many of them lived, and it's so remarkable that at this stage, so many of them are still with us and living in this city, chief among them, Ambassador Young. So thank you for being here. Peter Clark has just retired as the senior scholar at the Poynter Institute, but he hasn't stopped writing. He's got at least four books to his credit, but probably more than that, and they are taught widely in schools, writing tools, x-ray reading, the glamour of grammar. I really wanted you to have that line. Right. And he also was very close with Gene Patterson back when he was the chairman of Poynter and was one of the editors of the book, The Changing South of Gene Patterson, that Ambassador Young is holding there, that came out some years ago. So I just want to, the last thing I really want to say that's promotional is that there are a couple of flyers that are outside here, but also at the Emory tent on Gene Patterson, and another one on the journalism collections that are at Emory. You can reconstitute, you can walk into the Rose Library at Emory and reconstitute the entire Atlanta Journal and Atlanta Constitution newsrooms. but given the holdings that they have, and as well as other journalists from the New York Times, Claude Sitton, John Herbers, an amazing collection. But anyway, what I'd like to do is just set up the stage here of what we're going to be talking about and try not to rob too much time here. I showed you that. This was a nice just piece of art that was in an Atlanta magazine piece. It probably doesn't show that well from here, but that a story that I was able to produce about Gene Patterson after we got the collection. And they did a beautiful job of showing the collection on their pages. Gene Patterson was born in 1923 in Adel, Georgia. And if you look at this picture, it's about where his elbow is, okay? His father, he got his indoctrination into the politics of the state came early when his father, who was a liquidation agent for the state banking authority, was asked by a disciple of Eugene Talmadge, the governor, to cut a deal and give some land cheap that was being liquidated to one of Talmadge's friends. And Mr. Patterson, Gene Patterson's father, said no, and he was fired the next day. And that's how he became on the anti-Talmadge side of life. Gene went to North Georgia College up in Dahlonega, and one of the first things he did was he joined the Bugler, the newspaper there, and it was 1942. Many of you who know this history will know that Eugene Talmadge was taking power and was trying to name himself the recruitment agent for all institutions of higher learning. He was firing professors and deans and hiring his friends for those jobs, and Gene wrote a strong editorial against him, and he got his revenge on what Talmadge did to his father that way. He later went to the Grady College at UGA and graduated. He joined UPI, and two things I want to tell you about his times in UPI. He did something pretty amazing in South Carolina, in Columbia. He used to do this most remarkably courageous thing. He would run stories about black people, and the Associated Press would not. And the editor of the black newspaper, the White House and Informer, would bring him press releases, and he'd run them. And one day, the head of the AP Bureau came into his office, and that had never happened. And he said, "Gene, I'm a little disturbed that you seem to think that the colored people here are making news." And Gene says, "Yeah, what about it?" He said, "Well, you don't think they're really newsworthy, do you?" And Gene said, "Well, I guess I do. I guess I do." He hadn't really thought about it. He just didn't think it was a challengeable point. But he did that, and it made a difference in the kind of reporting that came out of there. I also want to tell you that he later gets moved to New York and then to London. He happened to be in London on May 17th, 1954, when the Supreme Court hands down Brown. And he gets a call. I'm going to click to it. And the call is from New York saying, "We understand that Ralph McGill is in London, and somebody needs to get his response to the Brown versus Board decision." And Gene calls every hotel in London trying to find him. He had never met McGill. They had crossed paths once, but he never met him. And he finally gets him on the phone and gives him the news. And McGill had not known the news to that point. And McGill said, "Well, I just have one question. What was the vote?" And Patterson says, "It was unanimous." And waits, and McGill says nothing. And Patterson says, "Is there anything else you'd like to say?" And he said, "No, I think that's all." But within 4 years, Patterson was here. He had been hired to the Journal. He had become, and by 1950, that's 56, by 1960, the Cox family decides they want to name Ralph McGill publisher of the two papers, frankly, so they can pay him more money. They make Gene Patterson the editor of the Constitution, and you have this dynamic duo that even Richard Nixon confronted and failed to confront him one time. That's McGill on the left, in the center, I should say, and Patterson on the right talking with Richard Nixon. Let me see what else we got here. Just, you won't be able to see that too well, but it is a great photograph up in the right of McGill and Patterson on the eve of John Kennedy's election, when they pulled out an old cannon from the that had been the Atlanta Constitution building since the days of Henry Grady, and had been first fired by Henry Grady in 1884 to celebrate the election of Grover Cleveland as president. And it was a tradition to fire the cannon whenever a Democrat was elected. Here you have, you can barely see McGill leaning down, and Patterson with his arm up in the air firing the cannon on the night that John Kennedy was elected president. A couple of more things I just want to, I think Roy may talk about this other thing. In 1963, three churches were burned down in Terrell County, terrible Terrell, and Gene Patterson led the campaign to raise money to rebuild all three of those churches. And he said, you know, I want money from white people, because white people destroyed that. And he got a voluntary architect, Joe Amasano, to contribute his time. He got Roy McLean, the pastor of the all-segregated First Baptist Church, to serve as treasurer. And then the Trappist monks called and said, we'd like to do the stained glass. And they did. And I want you to know that through some work that I've been doing down in Terrell County, those churches are still there and they're still in business, okay? Lastly, everyone knows about the 1963 church bombing in Birmingham. Gene Patterson lived on Normandy Drive and off West Wesley. He was mowing his lawn when he gets a call from the Atlanta Constitution that says, Gene, you're going to want to know about this. Now keep in mind that Gene Patterson and Ralph McGill both wrote 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year, okay? And so Gene, by that Sunday, had already submitted his Saturday, Sunday, and Monday columns. And they called and said, you're probably going to want to sub out that column and put something else in. And Gene said he did. He rode down to the office. He was mowing his lawn when they called him. And he drove down and he wrote what many people would believe to be the most beautiful signature piece to come out of editorial and commentary writing during the civil rights period, and that is A Flower for the Graves. And I would recommend that one of these flyers that you can find has it there. 1966, Gene wins his Pulitzer Prize, as I mentioned. He wrote, that was the year of the Julian Bond was not being, they weren't seating Julian Bond, and he advocated for Julian Bond be seated in the Georgia legislature and not be evicted. It was also the year of the Summerhill riots, and I want to know, he took on SNCC. He thought SNCC was pushing too far, too fast, and creating a dangerous situation. This is a memo, just quickly, that goes to the time of the Selma March, when both McGill and Patterson were very concerned that the Atlanta Constitution and the Atlanta Journal were not sending reporters down there. And he tells a very painful story here. He writes a letter to the publisher, Gene Patterson does, and says, this is a very difficult time. We are embarrassed that you are not, he doesn't use that word, I'm paraphrasing, that you are not sending reporters to cover Selma. And we have this situation where Tom Winship, the editor of the Boston Globe, has called McGill and asked McGill if our man in Selma could file a story to the Boston Globe so they can have a story about Selma. And McGill says to the editor of the Boston Globe, Tom Winship, I'll have our man in Selma do that, but he's really busy right now. So McGill himself sent in 6 pages of copy to the Boston Globe to try to cover for the fact that the Atlanta paper had no one there. He leaves pretty soon after that, but Patterson goes to the Washington Post. There you see Ben Bradley in the center, and you can't see it that well, probably, but two to the left is Gene Patterson. It was another dynamic team. But the Washington Post newsroom was moving forward very aggressive. That relationship, I'm going to show you, did run into trouble, and maybe because Gene Patterson had more chips in front of him than Ben Bradley, I can't tell. Gene was deeply involved in the publication of the Pentagon Papers. He was the guy who was in there who put it on the presses, got it out on the street after a judge said you can publish. And by the time another judge had overruled it and said, sorry, you can't, Gene already had the papers on the street. Okay, and then another judge says, no, you must stop. They stopped, but the lawyers for the Washington Post went in and said, well, if they're already out on the street, it's kind of too late. You know, the cat's out of the bag, you can't undo that. So in fact, the judge said, we agree, and Gene started to press us up again, and he's in the middle having a toast with a couple of the other editors after they did that. You can't read this, but I will tell you that until you go through the Rose records, you will not see this letter. It's never been seen before by anyone who's ever done research or history on the Washington Post, and that's Gene Patterson's letter of resignation. He and Bradley just were beginning to clash. There wasn't enough oxygen room for both of them, and he said that Bradley was giving him too limited responsibilities. He was eclipsing it. And Bradley wrote a really nice letter back, and again, had no time to read it all. In the end, it worked out well. There's Kay Graham and Gene Patterson many years later. The friendship went on for quite a while. So I just wanted to quickly give you that summary of his life before he gets down to St. Pete and where Roy first met him. And Roy, I'm done with that. So I was gonna ask you,
So I just want to say that Gene Patterson, like his best friend and mentor, Ralph McGill, knew how to look evil in its eye and call out its name. He pulled no punches. In his most famous column on the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham, Gene blames white Southerners collectively, including himself, for setting the stage upon which four young black girls would be murdered. Dynamite. Athletes have moves, like the crossover dribble. So do writing athletes. Gene knew the language of moral outrage and used it when needed. But he had other moves, and one of those moves feels especially important to me, I think, for our day and age. When it came to desegregation, and the movement towards equality and racial justice, he realized that white folks, and black folks for that matter, did not exist in homogenized groupings, but rather along a spectrum of experience and opinion. When it came to his fellow white Southerners, especially the ones who were segregationists, he had this one move he could make time and time again. It would go something like this. I know that this person disagrees with me, does not believe in the mixing of the races, but he did something that I think you should know about. In September of 1960, an African-American school teacher sent Gene a letter telling him about a good experience that she had with a white state trooper. She'd gotten into a car accident in a rainstorm, and the trooper politely helped her out. Gene reprinted the teacher's words of gratitude and held up the state trooper's courtesy as a model, an alternative to the standard actions of the bullies who held the same job. This is the one that came to mind when Hank called me to participate in this. On July 8, 1964, Gene wrote a column titled, A Segregationist Speaks. Here is what he wrote, and I'm going to read two or three paragraphs. This is Gene speaking now. When I read what Louis Dersen, 50, of Columbus had done at Lakewood Park in Atlanta, I telephoned him long distance. You probably don't agree with my views on race relations and my opposition to Governor George Wallace, I began. I certainly don't, Mr. Patterson, replied Mr. Dersen, who was a segregationist, a believer in Wallace, and a member of the Columbus Citizens Council. I know you don't, I said, but I want to say to you man to man that I admired the courage you showed here last Saturday. When other white men began beating Negroes with metal chairs, Mr. Dersen shielded a 19-year-old girl from the attack and took many blows while doing it. He later expressed disgust for the violence of a few, which, as he said, which had given us a black eye nationwide. There was a sort of a pro-Wallace rally. There were protesters, and the protesters began to be beaten. And this 50-year-old white segregationist threw his body over one of the protesters to protect her. Mr. Dursley, I said on the telephone, I think most people agree with you and me that this violence in our state is wrong. You and I disagree on Wallace and other things, but I believe the people who agree with you on those things would listen to your thinking about violence when they might not listen to mine. So Jean asked him to have a say, and he does. Says, I don't think, Mr. Dursley, Gene says, Mr. Dursley, a citizens council segregationist and a Wallace backer, got a blow in the head from a metal chair and several nasty phone calls because he stood up for his belief and shielded a girl from a physical injury at Lakewood. What he really stood up for, I think, was the honor of Southerners who are still segregationists but who don't believe in beating and hurting people. One of Gene's readers, not an admirer, approached him one day with this accusation. He said, I know what you're trying to do, Mr. Patterson. You're trying to make us think that we're better than we are. President Lincoln had a name for it. Both he and Gene Patterson spoke to the better angels of our nature. Looks like we could use those angels again. Thank you, Gene.
And at that time, You have to figure that was worth about $1 million. 300,000 on each of the three networks. And we focused on demonstrations in a way that the demonstration was so defining the evils we were protesting that we could depend on the news media to reinterpret that meaning, and we could depend on the 6 o'clock news to take it nationwide and worldwide. And I think that's been one of my arguments with young people today, that they think that militancy is emotion.
That's right.
And that's exactly the opposite.
That's right.
Of what Martin Luther King, and even what my parents and grandparents taught me in New Orleans. You know, growing up on the corner of the Nazi Party, I mean, the Nazi Party headquarters was 50 yards from where I was born. And so at 4 years old, I had to know how to deal with racism. I mean, to get back and forth to the grocery store. And so it's never been easy, but I don't know that we could have made it without journalists who were equally sensitive. And one of the things that I always remember Howell for is an article that he wrote for the New York Times Magazine about how he got educated about race by the 16-year-old young lady that helped him grow up. And the differences we face now are even more complex. And I put them in simple categories, oversimplification, but we have a problem where we're living in a global environment, and everything is global, but we're still thinking national and regional. And I think with our president, all of his politics is national, but all of his business is global. And we don't have a brain trust in the media now to lead us through that complex period in which we live.
You know, it has been said that McGill and Patterson saw this, the South, as representative, or as part and parcel of the global anti-colonial movements that were taking place all across the world at the time. How you got to know Gene when you were in Atlanta, he actually hired you away, and then I know you were with him until the very end, right?
Yes. About 2 years before Gene died, he was to come to Fairhope, Alabama, where I lived in the winters, and visit my wife and me with Phil and Joyce Gailey. Phil was an Atlanta Constitution and New York Times reporter, and they were very close. And he called and canceled the trip because he'd just gotten a terminal diagnosis of cancer, and he sort of dropped out of his normal contacts. We were very worried about him, and he was very depressed. And I mention this because he died with such dignity, and in this as he was in everything that I ever encountered with him, a role model. After about 2 or 3 months, he declined treatment, but his doctor, who was a close friend, talked him into taking limited radiation to control pain from his spinal cancer. And then he very quickly resumed his life. He was lucky to be pain-free, and for the next year and a half, he had a wonderful time to spend with his family, his grandchildren, who he loved very dearly, and with his friends, and a number of us made pilgrimages to St. Petersburg for visits. And I say this as a prologue to the fact that Gene was one of the best letter writers I've ever known. He would throw away phrases in a casual letter that most writers would work all day to get, and he'd spend them, you know, like pennies. Anyway, he wrote me a lot of letters during this period, and I wrote him, and I wrote a letter in which I said, despite the advances of the Tea Party, I thought there were signs that there were some people in the Republican Party who might move back to the old centrist model of Rockefeller and Ford and so forth. And he wrote back and he said that would be a nice development. But remember, he said, they're all Republicans and you can't trust them. So, Phil and I were eulogists at his funeral, and I told that story, and a friend who was in the audience said, three quarters of the audience sat straight up. So he was speaking truth, even from the grave. The other thing I wanted to share is Gene, the formative experience of Gene's life was being a second lieutenant in Patton's tank command in World War II, and he was involved in the Battle of the Bulge as a 20-year-old second lieutenant with a tank crew. And Patton's idea was that the second lieutenants should ride with their heads out of the tank so they could see where they were going. So Gene told me this wonderful story. He assembled all of these tank commanders, Patton did, for a speech before they launched this big advance that would result in the Battle of the Bulge and the eventual taking of Berlin. And he said Patton spoke in a very matter-of-fact way, despite his reputation for bluster, and he said, now, a lot of you young men have not been in combat, and this is going to be very rough. And when you start, the first time you're shot at with a heavy cannon or another tank, your instinct is going to be to stop and try to take cover. That will get you killed. The only way to survive this, or have a chance of surviving, is when you're fired upon, keep moving forward and keep firing. And the simple genius of that was, I'm sure in military terms, absolutely correct, but it became a metaphor of thinking about Gene. From the first time he started writing about race in the South, he kept moving forward and he kept firing. And I think if you want to see the difference that newspapers can make in cities, you can look at Birmingham, where I grew up, where the local papers would not carry Ralph or Gene's columns, even though they were syndicated. And Atlanta, which had journalists of conscience, and it had the advantage of the Atlanta universities, the black churches, the SCLC, and the local businesses in Atlanta were owned locally, Coca-Cola and others. All those forces made this a special place, and Fort Birmingham was a colony of U.S. Steel. And so that tale of two cities has always been a great lesson to me, and I think Gene Patterson and some of the people that Ambassador Young named are central to the differences between Atlanta and some of the other places in the South. And I want to tell you briefly about something that Ambassador Young won't remember. I met him when I came to the Constitution. I got the idea of doing an oral history of the Civil Rights Movement. He was in Congress, or running for Congress, I forgot the exact order, and I got an appointment with him. And he knew me as a reporter. We didn't know each other well, but he, and so I went down to interview him. He took 15 minutes, and I did a long presentation about this book that I was going to write, and how moving it had been to me to move from Birmingham to Atlanta in 71 and see all of the great figures of the Civil Rights Movement, Ambassador Young, Reverend Abernathy, Jose Williams, all of these warriors here. And I said, I'm going to write a book of interviews. I'm just going to interview y'all, and I want you to help me. And I particularly want you to help me get an interview with Mrs. King. And he said, okay, he would try to do that. He said, but when you go to see Mrs. King, be better prepared than you are today. She doesn't have a lot of time to waste.
You know, boy, I don't want to totally abandon the theme, what would Gene say now? Can you help me on this?
You know, so I would say that I think Gene, when Gene was, I want to repeat the fact that from 1960 to 1968, Gene wrote a signed column for the Atlantic Constitution every single day. And he didn't write, he told me that he didn't write two a day, because the second one would not be up to his standard. I found these, he showed these to me in albums in his closet. I took them home and I read all 3,200 of them. And it's an astonishing journey. And what it shows is what happens when the language, the craft, is matched to a noble mission and purpose. Gene pushed off praise that he was courageous and always pointed back to people like Ambassador Young and John Lewis as the true warriors of civil rights. That said, he kept a ball-peen hammer in his desk drawer for the day that someone would come in the office to do him harm. Mm-hmm. He got a phone call from his 8 or 9 year old daughter, Mary, telling him that someone had shot the dog and that she knew who had done it. Who did it? It's someone who doesn't like what you're writing, Betty. That dog, named Elizabeth, by the way, lived to 18 years old with a bullet an inch from her heart. And I think our current circumstance, in which the President of the United States is calling journalists the enemy of the people, while there are journalists in Texas today, where there are journalists all over the world risking their lives to tell the truth and to tell the truth, this is a shame, and we should revisit the courage of journalists like Gene Patterson in order to inspire them.
Louisiana federal court in 1941. So by the time I came to Atlanta in 1961, I had 20 years of legal background, definition of the problems by all of the finest law schools in the country. And we were on the same page. We might have been at different chapters at different times, but by and large, we had built a national consensus around race that we had a hard time struggling from out of Civil War and Reconstruction. And so I was saying that when Maynard got elected, the first challenge he had was what to do about the cyclorama. Yes. And we decided that we wanted it preserved and protected. So we sold $6 million worth of tax-exempt municipal bonds to restore and perpetuate the cyclorama, which was the Battle of Atlanta from the Civil War. But when it was finished and I hired the person to be the curator, it was a young woman who had been in the civil rights movement, white, but had a history degree from Emory. And so we got good, honest history about the cyclorama. And everybody, no matter what side you were on, and it became for us the birth of the New South, mm-hmm. not the death of the Confederacy. Now,
well, let me.
That's where I think I would look for a Gene Patterson right. or Ralph McGill right now to help us to resolve the remaining conflicts.
Do you think that news organizations today can provide the moral authority, or is it just too diffuse and too confusing now? How you've been an editorial page editor and run a newsroom.
Yes, being an editorial page editor is really great because nobody can talk back to you until it's too late. But I struggle with the fact that I was very lucky. Roy fits in saying that those of us who came into the newspaper business around the time of the Civil Rights Movement, worked in Atlanta, worked in New York, we saw the last golden age of American journalism. I really believe that. Now, that doesn't mean something else is not coming, but we have to understand that the internet is the most powerful communication vehicle ever invented, and it's totally agnostic as to truth. So this presents a canvas on which journalism has to take place that's new in human history. Technological change always brings disruption. I'm not very optimistic about where we're going, but I may be wrong, and the fact is I don't know. And I don't think anyone in the industry knows. But I do want to say this. If you want to follow the best reporting on Donald Trump, I'm very proud of the work that the group of young reporters at the New York Times, the Washington Post, and NBC are doing. But let me add a caveat, and this is what we don't yet see. One of the things that we found at the New York Times, we saw the internet coming, and we said, we don't worry about it because we've got quality information, and people who want quality information to put on their cable shows, to put on their websites, have to come to us and pay us. What we didn't reckon for was the disappearance of the audience for quality information. That's the strict, the thing we're up against.
If we go ahead and answer, I'm going to try to sneak in a couple of questions. So anybody prepare to stand up quickly. So
the civil rights movement that we were a part of was to redeem the soul of America from the triple evils of racism, war, and poverty. I would contend that where we are not yet on the same page is we should be talking about poverty. And if we're talking about poverty, then the skinheads and the white supremacists and the little boy who did the shooting in Mother Emanuel Church is a sick, poor white kid. And it doesn't help to condemn him because his senator gave his family black lung jobs instead of affordable health care.
That's
right.
That's right.
And so I think we've got to redefine the moral issues.
And you need to have editorials that make that case.
Yeah.
Because I think to connect those dots. We're going to sneak in some questions, but I want it to be the last event of the day because I knew we could bust deadline. Wrong? So they may want to pull the cord on this, but I want to keep going a little bit. Does anybody have a question? And if not, anybody? May I say one thing? I don't want to overlook that Gene Patterson's last act on his deathbed was a very simple task. He rewrote the Bible. And he published a book called Cord. And he said, the Bible makes no sense to people. I'm going to write it in such a way that people will understand it. And he did that. In fact, to your point, I wrote him a letter and said, Gene, you're the only one I know who is audacious enough and skilled enough to rewrite the Word of God. And he sent me, and I told him also some work that some students are doing down in Terrell County, where the church burning was, work that some of my students are doing down there. And he sent me back a letter that the opening line was, Hank, you send me up the road. Your praise sends me up the road, a happier man. And he was dead within days of that, you know.
I reviewed the book for the Tampa Bay Times, and I described disagreement we had about, I thought it was a wonderful idea to sort of condense the Bible, except for the 23rd Psalm. And I read,
is nothing sacred?
Yeah, my cup runneth over. Now we can cross that out.
We have a question here. Thank you all.
I want to say it's an honor to have all of you. Certainly, there was a golden age of journalism, and there's a pile of complete crap on the internet. There's no question about that. There's also some very good stuff and some very good long-form journalism that is happening on the internet and in other places. So I think we reinvent ourselves all the time. They're right here at this event. We're seeing some incredibly well-written and well-researched books. So I'm not quite as hopeless. And you know, the past is always prelude to the future. I wrote a piece about Donald Trump 3 weeks before the election called It Could Happen Here, and I was referring back to a book by Sinclair Lewis called It Can't Happen Here about the election of a fascist in the United States. And so...
Well, thank you.
That's my point.
Can I mention something very quickly here? Is that I think I remember since I learned in college at Providence College something called the myth of the golden age, and that's the idea that when things are bad in the present, we look to the past for that time. You know, I tell my younger colleagues, and this is, I remember 1968 very, very well. And it was not a good time. It was not a good year. And so I think one of the things that journalism can always do is to remind people of history and to help them figure out how to interpret the current circumstances by the past.
I would have never figured in 1968 that Jimmy Carter would have been president in 76. And the things that happened between 68 and 76 are, I mean, that was another age of consolidation and change.
And he wouldn't have been president, if I might say, if Daddy King had not gotten him out of hot water over ethnic purity.
Yep.
I really believe that. And you were there.
Yes, sir. You have a question?
Yes. I like your shoes, Roy. In college, I worked as a copy clerk in the newsroom at the St. Pete Times, and I had the honor of delivering mail to Gene Patterson on a number of occasions. I just want to know, any of you think that there are any journalists on the level of Gene Patterson today?
Could I take another swing at that? Yes, I'm sure there are. And I've cited a few examples of people I think are meeting that standard. The problem is the platforms that we had, the New York Times, that Gene had at the Constitution, those platforms are much diminished. So it's a very disparate, balkanized media universe. And I don't think we will see anybody become James Reston. Become Gene Patterson or become Tom Wicker in this current environment. There's not enough concentration of audience. And the other thing that's happening is places that the civil rights movement, as Ambassador Young said, was won on the 6 o'clock news, and Dr. King had the brilliance to see that before anybody else. And the audience for serious television news is shrinking. If you turn on the three network shows, which were essential to the movement and essential to changing the South, what you see is ads aimed at a disappearing audience for diapers and various kinds of old age remedies. And so, yes, there's talent out there, probably better than anything we had, but the soapboxes that we had the advantage of don't exist right now.
You know, it's also worth noting that at the time, it seemed so much simpler, but when the federal government was deciding how far can they push in the South, how much traction can they get, they were happy to see a McGill and a Patterson writing what they were writing, because that gave them cover with white people. And they wanted McGill and Patterson writing to white people as they did, and saying, you're the ones who were enslaved here by your ideology. And they loved to see Potty Carter write what he was writing, because it gave them an opportunity to send John Doerr in and get a foothold there. So they knew that there would be voices in the South, white voices, who would give them cover. It's not so simple today on those sorts of things. But thank you. Quick question.
I'll try to make it quick. Well, Mr. Raines said that, and I thought it was a very interesting comment, that what we did in the New York Times, what we didn't reckon for was a disappearance of an audience for quality information. And my question is that your analysis of the problem that we face as a nation and as the problem we face as journalists? If so, why? And if not, what is your analysis of the problem? This is for everyone.
Thank you for asking it. I was speaking in shorthand, perhaps. The question of whether there's an appetite for quality journalism is one that we can argue either way. The point I was trying to make was an economic point. The people At the height of the newspaper industry, the readership of the Boston Globe, the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, New York Times, LA Times, was probably 10 million people in this vast nation of then 300 million. So it's a tiny audience. And what has happened that's crippled the newspapers is that the people who are willing to pay a premium for quality information, that audience is hunkered down and they haven't disappeared. And that's the point I was trying to make. Mm-hmm.
Where does the onus lie then? Does it lie with the papers? Does it lie with the people for responsibility?
Well, I think the technological aspect lies with the papers. The my generation of journalists were about how to deal with the threat of the internet. And one, we underreacted, and two, we didn't understand what was going on. And here's a sad fact about newspaper economics. What killed newspapers in the end, or killed the business model, was classified ads going to eBay,
Craigslist.
That those classified ads provided about 10% of the revenue of the average newspaper, and when they fled, that was the final 10% that kept their heads above water. So
can I mention that just a few years ago, the first website, I believe, to win a Pulitzer Prize belongs to the St. Petersburg Times, which became the Tampa Bay Times, for something I think maybe everybody's seen right now, something called PolitiFact. And from that innovation, there is now, and it works out of the place where I work, the Poynter Institute, an international consortium of fact checkers who are doing their best at a time of what some people are calling fake news and propaganda and everything like that, to really, really work hard at trying to sort it out. And so I want to say that even in the face of the kind of economic stress that Hal was talking about, there is innovation, there is creativity, and there's definitely devotion to mission and purpose.
All right, we're way over time, but I'm going to take this question and this question, and then and we'll try to give you good, terse, but meaningful, deep, profound responses.
Thank you. So my question is, I think before you talked about people not being interested in hearing the truth and in reality anymore, or less people being interested in it. Why do you think that's happening, and what would people have to do to wake people up and bring them back?
So, Gene was a white Southerner writing for other white Southerners. And that's a very, very interesting model, which is to say that someone inside a tribe was trying to move it. And now it seems as if we're sort of alienated in our echo chambers and unwilling to hear the voices from outside sort of coming in. So it has to be, one of the things I think would be, was the courage of insiders to kind of say, there's another way to do this, there's a better hope.
And my political job is not worth the position I'm taking.
Mm-hmm. May I elaborate on this question? And I'd like to hear Congressman Young on this. He spent a lifetime in the business of conversion. And he mentioned a moment ago what I think is a very salient fact, which is the people in this country who desperately need universal health care are the same people who voted for Donald Trump. And we can all cite examples of that. What will it take to get reverse that phenomenon of people voting against their own interest on these key social issues?
Well, if you get home by 8 o'clock tonight and watch Alabama and Florida State, you will see integration at work at its best. And I said, somebody slipped up and said, you know, when you come right down to grassroots Georgia, Herschel Walker probably had more impact on Georgia than Martin Luther King. Now, you may not like that, you may not want to hear that, but Herschel Walker came from Wrightsville and made Georgia number one, you know, and ran over Notre Dame and won the Super Bowl, I mean the Sugar Bowl. And there isn't a better loved person in Georgia than Herschel Walker. Now, I mean, you still, Martin Luther King is still controversial. Herschel was not. Now, I'm not diminishing Martin saying that the things that we have in common as Southerners are still greater than the things that divide us. And it takes a little time for it to happen, but I can't imagine. History is also moving faster now than it was in the 60s. So if it took us 10 years to get a stable Southern platform established politically, we might do it in 5.
Okay, last question.
All right, this question is intended especially for Mr. Clark, but anyone is free to answer, of course. Having read so much of his writing and, you know, really assimilated the gestalt of what made him such a good writer, beyond just existing in a particular epoch and having a particular identity, speaking to a particular audience, as has, you know, been alluded to several times during today's discussion, do you think there were any particular strategies that he deployed, anything in his writing beyond what's been mentioned today that made his a particularly clarion voice that, you know, carries forward to today's environment?
So let me read some very quickly for you. September 16, 1963, a flower for the graves. A Negro mother wept in the streets Sunday morning in front of a Baptist church in Birmingham. In her hand, she held a shoe, one shoe from the foot of her dead child. We hold that shoe with her. One of the things that stories allow us to do is to experience life through the eyes, through the heart, through the soul of others. And Gene understood that, and all good writers understand that. That stories teach us who the villains are, but they also teach us how to love each other. And there's a saying that I think I learned from Jim Dwyer in the New York Times. An editor told him, the bigger, the smaller. The idea is that there are some stories that are so big, like 9/11, that rather than try to understand it all, Jim Dwyer told a story about one family photograph that fluttered down to the rubble of 9/11, and somebody who found that and was determined to return it to the family. So it's that one shoe, that Gene chose, that expresses, that detail tells us so much about the power of writing to give us empathy for those who may have a very, very different experience than us. He was very good at that.
Cannot be in the midst of the flood, and he will not ever admit that this is global warming, but he cannot deny the suffering, he cannot deny the pain, and a lot of the things, I mean, what he's experiencing today, if I were writing a newspaper, I'd call it the revenge of reality. All the things he's been saying, reality is saying it just ain't so. And sooner or later, we're going to find that out.
And I think that just as a closing remark, that what Gene Patterson would say is, he would never say, do what I did with Birmingham. But I think he would say to newsroom staffs all over the country, get out of the newsroom and go see it for yourself. see it eye to eye and tell it like it is, and be you know, he, every newspaper he was at, he encouraged writing, but writing from the reporting that you can see with your own eyes. Tell the stories of people. They don't have to be 8 feet underwater to be in serious trouble in this country. And those stories need to be told by news organizations. And it takes people out on the streets every day, in the homes, in the lives,